In this video, we will discuss about key architectures which are used across industry in many applications and projects. First is monolithic architecture. Monolith is one of the most used architecture pattern still prevalent in the IT industry. From UI, business logic, processing layer to repository, all bundled into single repo and deployed as single application. To make a simple change in application, it requires fetching the whole code base, updating it and building, and then deploying an updated version of the code. There are some major disadvantages of monolithic architecture. First, simple change requires whole application to rebuild, go through static code analysis via pipelines, and redeployment process. It is time consuming process. Second, if one process of the application experiences a spike in demand, entire architecture must be scaled. So it is not much scalable architecture. Third, if one process of the application experiences failure during startup time or runtime, it can affect entire application. Fault isolation is hard to achieve in monolith. There is also not much technological freedom. You cannot use multiple technology for the same project. Monolith are good for small projects, good for startups, because there is no much multiple code repository, CI/CD pipelines, multiple deployment maintenance head. The cost is very low in early stage of the project. In case of any error, debugging of the application is much easier. Nowadays, we also see big monolith decompose into modular monolith. This provides a little edge for deployment, and if the project is growing and becoming big, transition from monolith to distributed architecture. Now, let's talk about layered architecture. In layered architecture, components or module with similar functionality are grouped into horizontal layer. For example, all user interface code are present in presentation layer. All domain object translating code is present in business layer. In layered architecture, there is no restriction on the number of layers an application can have. Layer purpose is to promote concept of separation of concerns. This structure provides abstraction and encapsulation. Communication between layer will happen only with immediate top or bottom layer. Usually, skipping of layer is not allowed. Skipping of layer is not allowed, then it is called closed layer architecture. If skipping of layer is allowed, then it is called open layer architecture. This kind of architecture is easy to test. There is data consistency, availability, and low complexity involved if application is not big. But if application becomes too big and grown in monolithic fashion, then scalability, performance, and deployment could be concerned. Now, let's deep dive into event-driven architecture. What is event? An event is a change in state or an identifier. Identifier example is notification. Events are used to trigger and communicate between multiple decoupled services. This architecture has three key components. First, event producer, or simply we called producer. It publishes the event. Second is router or broker. It acts as bridge between producer and consumer. So producer and consumer are decoupled using router or broker. Some brokers like Kafka can store the event as well. Third is event consumer. It listens or subscribes to the event from the broker. Either you can directly send the event to broker, or if you need some transformation on the data, we can have event adapter. In order to avoid hard coupling Between event producer and event adapter, we place broker between event producer and event adapter. It gives us advantage of attaching multiple event adapters and transforming persisting message in any format we need. Event consumer listens to the upcoming message from the event broker. We can also attach multiple event consumer to the event broker. So, if you try to visualize data flow or event flow, it could be like event producer emits the data received by the event adapter, transformed by the event adapter, then went to the consumer to consume, process and persist the data to the data lake. Due to decoupling between producer and consumer, they can be independently scaled and deployed also. Where to use event-driven architecture? Then think of if multiple systems needs to operate in response to event. If you need to integrate multiple heterogeneous systems, if you want to operate in response to some alert or notification, then event-driven architecture is good one to go for. Now, let's talk about the last part, microservices architecture. Consider a very small service organized around single business capability. In a typical microservice architecture, request from user interface goes to API gateway. API gateway route request to corresponding service, and each service is responsible for persisting the data and exposing the data via APIs. Sometimes we also see patterns like database per service in microservice architecture. Communication between service happens over well-defined API. These services are loosely coupled, can be deployed independently, and highly scalable. This architecture provides technology agnostic services, fault isolation, and data isolation. Being so much advantage, this architecture introduces complexity of managing the whole architecture, managing multiple code bases, managing multiple CI/CD pipelines, network latency if there is multiple internal service-to-service calls, data consistency, debugging the application and tracking of request from end to end. If you want to track the request, you need to install additional systems like ELK stack. This was all about key architecture patterns. Let me know in comment which architecture pattern you are using in your project.